Hey there, Mr. Reddit here. Welcome back to another episode of r/EntitledParentStories. Our first story we'll be reading today, entitled Mom Tries Making Me Give My Spot Up for Her Daughter. After that, Am I the Jerk for Turning a Neighbor's Ableist Argument Against Them? And after that, Standing Up to My Workplace Bully Led to Unforeseen Consequences. Now for every thumbs up this video gets, one Karen gets stood up to. I dare you. So please smash that like button. And if you're new, subscribe and turn on notifications for new stories from Reddit every single day. Entitled Mom Tries Making Me Give My Spot Up for Her Daughter. So this happened last year, but I didn't have enough comment karma, so here we go. We've got me, we've got Entitled Mom, the Karen, we've got Entitled Kid, and we've got my dad. I had just graduated high school, and I was waiting for responses from the colleges I applied to. Well, the day came, I got my acceptance letter to a good college in my state. Well, my neighbors had a kid who graduated with me and applied to the same college. The only difference is that she didn't get accepted. So she jumped our fence. It isn't high since it was for the dog, and knocked on the door. So I opened it. The conversation goes as follows. Entitled Kid. Hey, did you get into that college? Me. Yeah, I did. Did you? No, because you took my spot. Me. Well, if you had actually tried in high school instead of slacking and turning to drugs, maybe you would have gotten in. Entitled Kid. I got all A's in middle school and high school, thank you, and vaping isn't a drug. Now the funny part is that in middle school, she had advocated against vaping, then ended up doing it a year later. As for the grades part, she started slipping in high school, resulting in her dropping from all of her advanced classes. So I just shook my head and watched her leave. I wasn't affected. She ruined her own life. Her mom and her came back over, and her mom was upset. With a wrath of fury, she knocked on my door. I opened it, having been woken by the knocking, and was pushed down to the ground. Entitled Mom. If you know what's good for you, you'd give up your spot. Me. My spot for the college that I worked towards since I was young? No way. Get out of here, Karen. Entitled Mom. My name is not Karen, and I demand you give your spot to Entitled Kid. Me. Listen, Entitled Mom, it's your daughter's fault for slacking. I'm not giving up my spot for her. My dad had heard screaming after a thud, so he came to see what was going on when he saw Entitled Mom screaming at me. My dad. What's going on, Entitled Mom? Entitled Mom. Your daughter stole my kid's spot for college. My dad. Oh, you got in. Well, I don't know what to tell you. She got in fair and square. Entitled Mom. No, she did not. She took my baby's spot. My dad. Listen. If you don't leave right now, I'm calling the police. Entitled Mom and Entitled Kid did leave, but not without threatening us first. And as far as I know, the kid still lives there, without a job, and is not in college. As for her mom, she got the cops called on her for trying to harass my sister. I, however, am enjoying myself with my roommate, who actually is the other person from my grade to make it into the college. As for my family, they're doing better now. My mom is a worker, however, so it's taking a toll on her still. But other than that, we're all good. Edit. Does this seem dramatic? Maybe it is. I'm a dramatic person at times. I probably made this bigger than it should have been, and there were parts cut out that I felt wouldn't fit, like the daughter didn't immediately go home. We talked after that. But I mean, the reason I know she was declined, because, well, she set it up there, right? Speaking of college, have any of you guys gone to college? And if you're planning on going, where would you go? Please let us know.
Your mom goes to college.
Am I the jerk for turning a neighbor's ableist argument against them? Fairly short one. I have autism, as does my son. A friend slash neighbor has made casual comments for years about how autism isn't real. It's overly diagnosed. Only children have it, and teens slash adults with autism are just using it as an excuse to not grow up. That autism is the result of bad parenting. The list goes on. The closest I've seen to him backing down is when one of his teenage sons called him out in front of me and told his dad what autism actually is, listing symptoms, at which point his dad declared that, in that case, we're all a bit autistic, and spent a few months telling anyone who'd listen that he's autistic too. Anyone who's dealt with someone like this before, sorry, I know your blood pressure already hit the roof, but earlier today I was straight up done with it. Anyway, my son and a few other neighbors are outside, all appropriately distanced and having a chat. My son is stimming with one hand, a sort of one-handed clap he does when he's excited, which helps him manage his symptoms. One of our neighbors, who doesn't know he's autistic, asks about the stimming and other more obvious symptoms, and the autism neighbor answers before my son can, telling Nice Neighbor that, apparently, my son is autistic, before launching into a monologue about how autism isn't a real thing. Nothing personal to my kid, he's a nice boy, but if I had done a better job raising him, he wouldn't have his symptoms, and that autism didn't exist when he was growing up. My son looks like he's about to cry, and after 9 years of this crap, I'm just done with it. So without really thinking, I lean into the conversation and tell him, autism's existed forever, neighbor. We just didn't know about it until recently. It's the same reason we used to judge soldiers with PTSD for cowardice and judge people with epilepsy for being possessed by demons. Note, his teenage son has epilepsy, which I know about. Your personal ignorance in the face of modern knowledge doesn't prove or disprove crap, and I don't know why you're so proud of the fact that your brain is still running 50 years behind the rest of the world. Not gonna lie, I was proud of that. I thought that was a decent burn, and I actually managed to get all of the words out in their intended order. I'm not an eloquent speaker. Welp, everyone's mad. Neighbors are mad, cause I swore. Note, the youngest person there was my son, who's 12 and cusses like a sailor. Everyone else present were teens and adults. Others thought I overreacted. Others think autism neighbor has a valid point, and even the ones who agree with my point think I was a jerk in my delivery. Son's mad that I embarrassed him. Autism neighbor is mad about being called out and blames me for the fact that he's now fighting with his epileptic son, who apparently is the only one who thinks I'm right, and his dad needed the takedown. The kid literally knocked on my door to tell me as much, and now autism neighbor is mad about that too. Am I the jerk? Wholesome update. Autism neighbor knocked on my door a couple of hours ago. It's 12:35 p.m. here, lunchtime, and apologized wholeheartedly. Apparently, two things happened after we went our separate ways yesterday. One, his teenage son found him some images of brain scans of people with different disorders, like depression, autism, ADHD, etc. He spent years looking at brain scans and readouts from his epileptic son, so seeing that for people with autism, how it's a physical difference in the brain, just like epilepsy, was the moment the penny dropped for him. He told me he's always just sort of assumed autism symptoms were personality traits and behavioral issues, so he never researched further, assuming he already knew it all. Once he actually Googled it, he realized how wrong he was, ate some humble pie, and came over. 2. He was standing side on to my son when he spoke, and was looking away from him towards our other neighbors, but he didn't see my son getting upset. His son, however, most definitely did, and when he told his dad that my 12-year-old was practically in tears over what his dad was saying, he was mortified. He genuinely hadn't realized that his difference of opinion could hurt someone, and he asked to speak to my son to apologize to him as well. I've mentioned it in a few other comments, but the neighbor is a genuinely nice guy in general. His comments were born of ignorance, not malice. He's outside chatting with the other neighbors now, it's a daily thing, and has already told them that he was in the wrong, admitted he's been making comments like that for years, and defended me to them for telling him off. It seems to have all died down now, though I do still want to speak to my son about how he's feeling. He just doesn't want to talk about it at the moment, so I'm giving him space. I think he'll be fine. Though I do accept that I was the jerk for not taking his wishes into consideration. I know I was defending him, but I still spoke over him without regard for how it would make him feel. I let my temper get the better of me, and whilst I do think I was justified, I definitely want to own the harm I did or could have done to him. Standing up to my workplace bully led to unforeseen consequences. Let me start this one out by saying that I fully intended to seek revenge on this person in this story, but the aftershock of the eventual confrontation is what led to the aforementioned consequences rather than by my direct actions. I work in the UK for a large technology company doing software support. I'm part of a team that has members all over the world. I've been in this job for around 10 years, and other than the major issues I've had with this guy, I truly enjoy my job. When I started with the company, I wouldn't say that I was green. I had about 7 years industry experience under my belt. I was definitely inexperienced with the company, but the job that I had been hired to do used technologies that I was more than comfortable with. The point I'm trying to convey here is that I wasn't completely oblivious to all the applications supported by our company. Everyone in my team, around 30 of us, was very nice and was very keen to help, except for Shane. Shane is probably what you'd term as the team guru. About 5 years from retirement, part of the office furniture, metaphorically, is we're all home workers. He had been with the company for nearly 40 years. Everyone labeled Shane as the only guy to go to when you were truly in a bind. When I was initially starting out, I did indeed find that Shane was highly knowledgeable and more often than not had the answers to whatever obscure questions you might have. Things were great, and our team ticked over nicely. I got to know the rest of the team well, over the phone, over time too, and my best friend was a woman named Mel. She was of a similar age and experience level to Shane, and in my opinion, was just as knowledgeable as him. One day, Mel and I were on a brief call chatting about a work issue when we got to shooting the breeze for a while. We talked about ourselves and also the team. I'd said that I hadn't met everyone face to face yet, and that was when she told me she had once met Shane in person a couple of years ago. They're both based in the US, I'm in the UK, and both got invited to a tech conference in New York. She told me that he has serious health issues due to his weight, around 450 pounds, and when he was home, was often on oxygen and medication. His plan was to ride things out until he was able to take early retirement so that he didn't need to worry about paying for his medical insurance anymore. That sounded like a reasonable enough plan to me, and we were soon talking about something else. The issue started about 2 years into my tenure with this company. We started moving in a new direction with what applications we were going to be offering to customers, and towards the end, we were trained in a bunch of new stuff. I saw this as a great opportunity and equalizer. If no one on our team had any experience with this new software, then I would be on equal footing with everyone. This went really well for me, and I put a lot of time and effort into learning as much as possible. Shane didn't show much interest in the new stuff. He still continued to spend most of his time with the legacy tools. In team meetings, you could clearly tell he was getting upset that his status as a guru was gradually becoming more and more meaningless. This wasn't anything personal. We work in software. We have to adapt in order to remain competitive. As time went on, it was becoming clear to the team how much work I was putting in, and I was well on the way to becoming the go-to guy for the new software. During this time, Shane would start sniping at me for anything he could plausibly manage. For example, if I was late to a team meeting because a customer call overran, he'd make sure to interrupt whatever was being said to comment something like, "Oh look, Ordos Deluxe has bothered to grace us with his presence," even though he'd been guilty of the same in the past. Things like email chains too. Almost anything I sent out that included him and our boss on an email, he would reply with some unrelated complaint or observation, completely irrelevant to what was actually being discussed. One day, Mel called me and asked me what my beef with Shane was. I truthfully told her that I had no beef at all with him and he just seemed to have it in for me. She said that if she managed to find anything out, she'd let me know. Things continued like this for a couple of years. I continued to be the go-to guy, and he continued to try and discredit me and generally paint me in as bad a light as possible. One day, we had a major incident, one that literally could have cost the company millions in SLA fines if it was not solved quickly. Our manager split us into teams to troubleshoot specific areas, and she paired me up with Shane. I wasn't happy about it, but whatever, I was a professional. We got on a call and started working through the issue. As our call progressed, it was becoming abundantly clear why he didn't like me. He knew nothing about the new application. He hadn't done any work on it at all. Everything I asked him to check, he needed hand-holding, even for the most basic of tasks. Eventually, I just shared my screen and said for him to watch me. I went into the guts of the system, through so many logs, explaining to him what I was doing the whole time, and eventually found the problem was with a recent patch we had installed. At this point, he dropped from the call. I don't think anything of this at the time. We use Skype for business, and it can be flaky. So I just continued what I was doing. Our process was not to roll back any changes until it had all been approved by the senior manager. As I was the one responsible for deploying slash rolling back patches, made some notes about what we needed to do, and then rejoined the main call. I wasn't worried at all, because bad patches happened every so often. They just didn't usually have this level of impact. As soon as I did, I got absolutely destroyed by the incident manager. Apparently, Shane had returned to the group call and informed everyone present that the outage was caused by an error that I had made in the deployment process and that Shane had told me what the correct fix was and I had refused to implement it then and there. I was furious. He had accurately told them the cause of the problem because it was me who literally demonstrated to him how to find it. I had even foolishly mentioned to him what I thought would fix the problem. Because of how long he had been with the company compared to me, only our immediate team knew the truth about who was really the better skilled person in this situation. His historical reputation still carried a lot of weight with people who didn't work day to day with him. Because this incident was so major, over 100 people were on this call, several of them two or three levels of management above our team. He made me out to be a reckless, incompetent idiot, and he was believed. Despite my manager's protestations, I was disciplined and given a verbal warning. He, meanwhile, was congratulated for steering the company away from a potential disaster and given a commendation. I was so angry. and a while later, Mel gave me a call. Apparently, Shane had been bragging to her about putting that smart punk in his place. She was shocked and asked him what he was talking about. His real beef was that he thought I had disrespected him by trying to take over his role as go-to guy for the new software. That wasn't my intention at all. I didn't see it as my fault that he was too lazy to do the work again. I lamented with Mel that she should have recorded the call. She laughed and said that Skype shows when you're recording a call, and he'd never have spilled his guts while being recorded. I immediately had a brainwave. I decided that I would confront Shane one-on-one. I pinged him on Skype and said that I wanted to talk. He responded with a smiley and just said, "Sure." I called him and let him know that I was recording this call, and the Skype notification popped up to let all participants know that this call was being recorded. I went right for it and accused him of lying about the major incident and said that it seemed like he had a major beef with me. As expected, he lied and said that he was sorry that I felt like I had to react this way. He said that he would need to talk to our boss about it. I said, "Wait 1 second," and turned off the Skype recorder. I then said that Skype isn't recording and that he knew exactly what he had done. His mask slipped at this point, and he said that he was perfectly in his rights to put me in my place. He said that you need to respect the longer serving people in jobs like this, and that he would do it again in a heartbeat. I didn't hold back. I called him a dinosaur who refused to move with the times and wanted to coast out his days here without doing any work. He said that he was a couple of years away from retirement, and he'd be darned if he was going to bust his butt for some shiny new software. I said to him, "Speaking of new software, has he heard of OBS? Of course he hadn't, and I suggested he Google it. I then hung up on him. Not long after, the messages started. He was begging me not to use the secret recording that I had taken. He said that if he gets fired, he will lose his retirement package and his medical benefits. I told him to go forget himself, and that he should have considered that before trying to get me fired. I passed all of this on to the relevant channels before really giving it any thought. Things set in motion, and sure enough, a few weeks later after a company investigation, he was fired. I heard from Mel that he had asked to take early retirement so as to keep his benefits, but this was apparently rejected. It all came out later that apparently he had significant debts and that he was counting on his retirement package to keep him financially afloat. With no job and no package, he had no money to pay for the medical treatment which he badly needed. He was in no state to get himself a new job, and his skills had stagnated so badly that he couldn't even get a new job online. Mel told me that he died about 6 months after this whole incident due to his ongoing health issues. I felt conflicted about this for a while, sharing that recording obviously contributed to his death, but I don't know how bad I feel about it. I'm a young guy trying to build my career, and he actively tried to destroy me. I should maybe have held off when he pleaded for me not to reveal the truth, but he was old enough and wise enough to not engage in the childish games he played. If he had known he'd be dead as a result of this, I'd maybe have done things differently. It's one that stays with me, that's for sure. I'm still at the company, and I can tell you all that I will never treat a new employee the way he treated me. So maybe the breaking of the cycle is the positive to come out of all of this. On a scale of 1 to 10, what would you rate this revenge? Please let us know.
Now that's what I call revenge.
Am I the jerk for not telling my neighbor I had started a college fund for his kid? Full disclosure, I 100% do not think I'm a jerk for this, but they are harping on it, and I am just looking for an independent opinion. I, 36, female, bought a rural property in 2016. This property has a very large yard and a long driveway. I also travel a fair bit for work. I was looking for a service to handle shoveling my driveway in the winter and handle mowing my lawn in the spring, summer, and fall, mostly because I'm gone a lot, but also because I just don't want to have to deal with it. I was talking to my neighbor, R, who said that his son, A, who's 14, was a hard worker and wanted to make some extra cash as he was saving for college. So A and I came to an agreement. Every weekend, he would mow my front and back lawn, and I would pay him $40. In the winter, whenever it snowed, he would come by and plow my driveway. Firm $40 a week, whether or not it snowed. He would just drive on over with his tractor and handle it. It worked very well for 4 years. The kid was a godsend. I foster dogs, and if I had to go out of town unexpectedly, he would come over and feed them and play with them and love on them and just have a grand old time, and he would be compensated accordingly for the extra work. All in all, I've probably paid him $3,000 to $4,000 a year for the work. I made good friends with his folks. I get invited to all the family parties. His older sister had a baby and I went to the shower. So it's obvious I have a soft spot for this kid. Knowing that he was working so hard to try to afford to go to school, every time I paid him, I would also set aside the same amount and I put it into an envelope. I was invited to a socially distant graduation party earlier this month. He graduated from high school and he's going away to a state school about 2 hours from us next month. I took that envelope full of cash to the bank and I got a check, which totaled out a little more than $12,000. I included this check in the card I got him for graduation and I thanked him very much for helping me all these years and wished him well as he moved on with his life. He was extremely thankful because his mom had been laid off and they were worried about how they were going to pay for school and they were trying not to let him go into debt. Now the issue. I was worried that his parents would think of this as charity because his mom had been laid off. This plan had been years in the making and I hadn't mentioned it to them because I didn't want them to count on it if for whatever reason I wasn't in the financial position to offer it when the time came. R called me extremely upset that I hadn't told them about the fund prior for two reasons. One, it overshadowed their gift to him, and two, they had spent so long worrying about how they were going to pay this, and if they had known about what I was doing, it would have saved them a lot of stress and problems. Am I the jerk? Well, what do you think? Is OP the jerk for giving her neighbor $12,000 to help him pay for college? Please let us know.
How dare she?
Karen thinks I'm faking a migraine because I don't look like I'm in pain. Some backstory for context. I'm a 29-year-old incomplete quadriplegic in a wheelchair with an acquired brain injury. Because of my brain injury, I get chronic migraines. My accident that caused my disability happened in 2007, so I've had a long time to learn how to deal with my migraines. Most of the time, it's just my brain sending pain signals when there isn't actually pain, so now I rarely even notice it. But on days that I do feel it, it can be debilitating. Anyone who suffers from chronic pain might understand the times when other people don't believe you're in pain because you don't look like you're in pain. That's me most of the time. This happened a few years ago when I was out shopping. My migraine was really bad that day, but I had to get some things downtown and I had nobody else to go get them for me. I had most of what I needed, but there were a few other things I needed help to reach. On any other day, I would be able to reach them, but I couldn't move much because of my migraine. There was another customer in the aisle who we'll call Karen. Me. Excuse me, ma'am. Could you please grab that for me? Referring to an item that was near her, but slightly out of my reach. Karen, without even turning around.
Get it yourself.
Me. I'm in a wheelchair. Karen, turning around.
So? Why can't you get it?
Me. I have a really bad migraine and can't lift my arms to get it. Karen.
No, you don't. My husband gets headaches sometimes. Just take some medicine.
She obviously didn't know the difference between a headache and a migraine. Me. Already did, but that did nothing. Karen.
Yeah, sure. Stop faking it and get it yourself.
Me. Not wanting to make a big deal out of nothing. Don't worry about it. I'll find a staff member. I left to find someone to help me, not knowing why she wouldn't. I'm not saying she had to because she doesn't work there, but it only involved her reaching to the side and passing me the item I wanted. It didn't seem like it would be an issue. I found a staff member to help me get the rest of what I needed. He was a friend of mine and is always happy to help me in any way he can. He knows my situation and the whole story about my disability. When we came back into the aisle, Karen was still there, and the second she saw me, she gave me a dirty look. Karen, talking to the staff member as he got what I needed off the shelf.
You know she's faking it, right? I see her in here all the time, and she can get things herself.
Staff, ignoring Karen and talking to me. Is that all, OP? Is there anything else I can help you with? Me. Yes, please. My migraine is intense today. Staff. I'll sort you out, OP. How about I let you use my staff discount? Me. Thanks, mate. It's hard to get good help around here. Referring to Karen and giving her a smirk as we left. I know that was petty, but I felt like she deserved it. I could see the annoyed look on her face at the words staff discount. It's nice knowing the staff. I know she didn't work there, so it wasn't her job, but some people are such jerks that helping someone is a major inconvenience, even for a second. I wish Karens would be decent human beings. A girl can dream. Am I the jerk for not calling my stepmom, mom? For context, I'm now 18 years old. I tried to keep it simple, but sorry if it's confusing. My parents separated when I was 3, and they have always been on good terms, so they shared custody. My mom remarried 2 years after the separation, and so I've grown up with my mom, my dad, and a stepdad. This isn't a cliche stepdad is the bad guy thing. We've always gotten along, and I have always seen it as a bonus to have an extra parent. I have always loved and respected him, and have always told him that. It took a while, but when I was 10, I started calling him dad, which is also the term I use for my biological dad. It took me a while because I wanted to make sure my biological dad was comfortable and also my stepdad. Last year, my dad also remarried to a woman we'll call Shauna. They had only been dating for 7 months, but Shauna had been a friend of my dad's for years, so they knew each other pretty well. She was my Aunt Shauna for ages. As with my stepdad, Shauna and I have always gotten along. We do clash a little sometimes, but that's more because we're both quite similar in terms of personality. Yesterday night, while cooking together, Shauna turned to me and asked why I didn't call her mom. I responded just by saying, "Because you're not my mom." I admit I could have worded it better, but Shauna got really upset. She started saying how for years she has been like a mother to me, which I admit is somewhat true because she was always in close proximity, like a guardian would be. But again, I just viewed her like an aunt. She then brought up how I called my stepdad, Dad, so what was the difference? I tried telling her that it took me years to start addressing my stepdad in that way, but she cut me off by saying that she and I have already known each other for years, so that was irrelevant. I want to make it clear that at no point was she mouthing or being rude, she was just genuinely upset. She then asked me if I would ever call her mom, and I said I don't know. My dad came home a little later, and he came into my room to tell me that Shauna was upset because I had said that I don't know if I would ever view her as my mom. And I said, A, that's not what I said, and B, at the end of the day, she isn't my mom, she's my stepmom. He, like Shauna, brought up my stepdad and how I viewed him like a dad and how it was unfair I wasn't giving Shauna the same chance. He also said it was quite petty and all I had to do was tell her I'd try calling her mom. Now this morning, my mom came to pick me up and I left without saying goodbye to Shauna. She wouldn't come out of her room. I feel really bad about it now, but I'm also really confused about whether or not I was really the jerk in the situation. So, am I the jerk? Edit. Thank you for all your responses. I'd try and get to them all, but there's a lot. I'll try to answer questions where I can. I texted Shauna a couple of hours ago to see if she'd be willing to talk, but she hasn't responded yet. There's no way of telling if she's even opened it, so I'm not going to assume she's ignoring me. My dad reached out to ask if I was okay earlier, and I said yes. Nothing else other than that. Sorry. I'll keep you all updated when Shauna responds. You wasted our time. Give us free stuff. Yeah. So this story ends with triumph for the entitled parents, not the poor people that had to deal with them. Could probably also count as choosing beggars, but it's here because my siblings' birthdays was the main subject used to manipulate the people at customer service. Cast. We've got my entitled manipulative grandma. We've got my entitled mother. We've got entitled sister. She's 12. We've got oblivious sister. She's 11. We've got oblivious brother. He's 9. And we've got me. I'm 18. So about a year ago, my family and I went on a road trip around America, something I've mentioned in more detail a lot in my other posts. We ended up in Florida for 3 weeks doing the theme parks, Disney World and Universal Studios most notably. This fell perfectly in line with OS and OB's birthdays on the 21st and 28th of October, exactly a week apart. For OB, we went to Legoland. The incident that happened there, I have detailed in another post, but for OS, we went to Disney World Animal Kingdom. For a little context, we pre-ordered the wristbands you need to use your fast passes well before the trip and got them on our first day at the parks in Magic Kingdom. Unfortunately, there was an issue and we had to get that sorted out, which took about an hour. We were given free fast passes for our troubles, and that should have been it. But no. Entitled Grandma and Entitled Mom realized they could use this to their benefit and concocted a plan to get more free stuff. And sadly, it worked. I say sadly because it means that they learned no lesson and got away with it, meaning they'll undoubtedly do it again in the future as it worked before. But I would be lying if I said I didn't enjoy the free things we got, even if I did feel guilty for being complicit. So the first part of the plan was to screw up our fast passes and get more. We basically ended up with double for one ride, and so one of our wristbands had an issue again. I'm not entirely sure whether or not they did something to it. They got the band fixed and ended up exchanging the double up for a universal free pass. Basically, it allowed us to get on any ride instead of a specific one. Then part two. This time, they screwed with the passes we needed to present along with scanning the wristbands in order to get into the park. Entitled Grandma and Entitled Mom forced us. Me. The others were happy to go along with it. to lie, and we ended up at customer service again, where Entitled Grandma really started laying it on thick. Entitled Mom isn't a charismatic manipulator like Entitled Grandma, so she opted to wait outside. I went in initially, but couldn't stay for the thing because it was just so wrong. Entitled Grandma told my three siblings to start crying and look upset. Entitled Sister needed no convincing and is rather manipulative in her own right. Oblivious Sister and Oblivious Brother were happy to do so as well because they were excited to get the rides Entitled Grandma had promised them if they did. This whole thing providing them with a lesson in how to manipulate, which is why I walked out. I couldn't watch them lay it on thick about all the problems Disney had given us. I wanted to say something, but I knew that if I had, they would have been furious at me for ruining their plan, and it would have made my life on that road trip even more miserable. If that was even possible. Call me selfish, but I didn't want another screaming match with my mother to ruin Oblivious Sister's birthday. So Entitled Grandma came out triumphant and bragged about getting free fast passes to the new Avatar ride, notoriously all ready for usually having a 2 to 3 hour line wait on average. Entitled Mom patted Entitled Grandma on the back and expressed how proud she was of the kids for their acting skills. We went about our day in Epcot, and they were all in good spirits for the day, and they knew they had the best ride for the OS's birthday the next day. I had an awful time, as I did end up getting into a fight later in the day with Entitled Grandma over something stupid that hadn't even been my fault, so it turns out my silence was wasted. It wasn't until we got back to our accommodation that Entitled Mom realized that Entitled Grandma could have gotten something better than the free passes and had her get on the phone to try to negotiate an exchange of the passes for tickets to Mickey's Not-So-Scary Halloween, something that would have cost us well over $1,000. And of course, she succeeded. She got the tickets and we're going to go the next night, giving Oblivious Sister an amazing birthday night as well as day. But it doesn't end there. Turns out that once the passes were generated, they went back into circulation instead of disappearing after we switched. When Entitled Mom found this out, she booked the passes again, and so we got both the Avatar ride and the Mickey's Halloween tickets for free. Again, I'd be lying if I said I didn't enjoy the ride or all the free candy I collected at Mickey's Not-So-Scary Halloween, but I still know how wrong this was, and my siblings' takeaway from all this is that lying and manipulation is the way to get what you want, something that Entitled Sister uses frequently with full knowledge of what she's doing, and Oblivious Sister and Oblivious Brother do now without fully grasping that that's not the right way to do things. If you enjoyed this video, we've got another one you're going to love. It just popped up on the screen, so come watch it and we'll see you when you get there.
And huge shout out to Connor, our newest channel member. Thank you so much for supporting the channel. Join as a channel member today and we'll give you a special shout out in our next video. And if you'd like us to make a special video for you or a loved one, come visit us on Fiverr, link pinned in the comments below.